on the dot.
No, in fact, I think we were at Material Cabin by 4.
No, I buzzed down there. I buzzed down. I left here and I buzzed because Ian said that I think they're going to Matera.
You might have maybe missed us.
I did see all the site work.
After 4, by the time we got to Matera.
I did see all the site work over there. It looked pretty good.
Yeah.
Parking lot and everything. Are they going to build a wall there, Mike, where they dug out all the dirt?
From what I was talking to Chuck, it sounds like they may just try to grade it back, put some of the stone that they still have, and build it up behind that, and then grade some of it back as well.
For no wall?
O'clock, Reading Conservation Commission, the 13th of January, and the first item at 7 o'clock is a continued request for determination of applicability, 2015-22, 27 Blueberry Lane, map 44, lot 102, Caganello. Is the applicant here? Hi. Would you like to talk about your project, please?
Sure. Being the furthest away from the actual conservation piece, I would estimate be about 90 feet height and only about 25 to 30 feet away from the hall. So if they did fall, they would pose risk to both, you know, my family, along with the home, and our newborn room is in the back of the house, along with the family room. So that would be the reason we're only looking to take down the 4 trees. We would leave the remaining 4 or 6 behind it, really just take down the closest to the home. And I have a letter here from the tree company.
Thank you.
We had a site inspection several weeks ago before the meeting. I believe it was it the 13th?
I'm just trying to find that. I took a picture and I sent that along. I don't know if anyone remembers that. Al, you don't, or, sorry, pardon me, Chuck, you don't happen to have
any
photos of this?
No.
My recollection was those trees were tall and straight. I didn't see any leaning.
Yeah, you were out on the site as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a... I thought they were straight, too. I don't know what how much bearing that has, though. I mean, they're...
I guess the concern is that they could...
It doesn't matter.
...fall over and do some damage to the home. They did look not in poor health. I think we commented while we were out there that they were in fairly decent health.
Yeah. I mean, with that consideration, I didn't see the reasons. I mean, any tree can fall on a house given a certain amount of, you know, tornado, hurricane, wind, and combined with an unhealthy tree. You know, and Redding is, used to have a flag up for, I think it was one of the Tree City USA towns. And I've seen lots and lots and lots of trees taken out, and ones that are most in need of being taken out are usually the sickest ones. And of these four trees, I didn't see cause to take them out right now. I just saw four fantastic tall pine trees in a backyard. So I'm leaning toward, you know, not agreeing with the request to remove the trees.
Even with the roots system pretty much above ground, the proximity to the home and
most roots that of trees that are close to wetlands like yours are. I mean, I don't think it's just a drainage system behind those pine trees. I think it's a large wetland area, isn't it? That was my.
We have neighbors right on the other side of the little.
It's a drainage swell.
Yeah.
Is it a drainage swell?
Yeah.
Let me pull up just really quickly a map so that I can just sort of orient myself. I'm sorry, I don't have the photos I took readily available right now. Let me just take a look at it, and if anybody else wants to comment.
Yeah, I don't really have a problem with taking down the trees. My thought since I've been on the commission is to replace them with trees of our authorization. And Chuck has a list that he can replace them with. And I don't think is the application for four trees?
There's
seven trees on the
at least in that area, but
yeah,
because taking down the most.
Those ones in the back, I mean, it looks like you have some on here that are like 96 feet away and 86 feet away. I'm not sure, you know, how much of a this one back. I'm not sure how much of a risk, you know, at 86 feet or at 92 feet, but certainly these closer ones, if he wants to take them down and replace them with some trees,
wrong,
I think that's fine.
Wrong project. That's Charles Street.
What are you doing?
That's Charles Street.
Oh.
Sorry.
I thought you had seven trees you wanted to come down.
No, it's four.
This is from the site visit that we were on.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
A while ago.
Yeah.
And I have to concur with Al.
I'm on the same page as well.
Because it seems as though several other projects similar to this, where the trees were close to the house, large trees, in relatively good health, that we allowed that. And we did, in many instances, look for replacement trees.
In my view, if you get a replacement tree in a better location, and you know, 30 years or so, get a long-lasting value out of it.
This project came before the commission, before with the old previous owner, and they wanted all the trees down, and it was denied because of the integrity of the stream bank. So we thought with the closest to the house, that would be at least a compromise, and that's why the applicant's not asking for all the trees. So, and they are quite tall, and so I think solid replacement trees would make sense. Maybe you could request a DBH that won't take 40 years to mature.
Yeah, that's fair. So what are you talking about for a diameter, like 4 inch or something, six inch?
You said you get them 10 to 15 feet.
10 to 15
feet,
3 to 6 inches, something like that.
Yeah,
that's fine. And we'll ask for two. Take down four and replace two, is that?
Usually one for one.
That backyard didn't look like, well, I guess it could take four. And you're going to end up with the same issues down the road, I think.
Well, if you if you planted them.
Plant some species, they're not gonna get 80 feet tall.
If you plant them closer to the wetland area.
Yep.
You know, you'd leave that area alone.
The only thing I'm thinking of, Nico, on the one-to-one is on the larger caliber trees, I mean, for an applicant, it becomes expensive. Those trees are getting into the $400 to $600 range on those larger caliber trees. So, you know, $2,500 to replace four trees is, I don't know if it's too much to ask, but it seems like it's a lot to ask.
Well, if maybe we could entertain a combination of, you know, for every large tree, 2 to 3 native shrubs, or, you know, something to contribute to
the
Chuck's
habitat
idea.
Of a couple, they're not going to take 40 years to grow, so maybe two bigger ones and four smaller ones, four shrubs along the bank or something. I'd be happy with that. Yeah, that's a good compromise.
Yeah, I like the shrub idea.
Yeah.
I mean, something that maintains the bank integrity.
Mm-hmm.
Provides a natural habitat of some sort.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it.
So do I hear a motion to issue a negative determination of applicability? Is that what we would be with conditions?
The only conditions I'm hearing is two 10 to 15 foot native trees off the list, and three shrubs?
Four
additional shrubs? And the one thing that I was just wondering is if you were going to restrict those trees in the future, the ones that are left from being cut down, or this isn't a typical case. I think they're all pretty close to the house. And
the ones that aren't being cut down?
Yeah, the ones that aren't being cut down.
I think we want to take it. So it sounds like they were rejected originally for the protection of the stream bank.
Yeah.
If they continue to be healthy, I think we want them to protect the stream bank, but conditions can change. You can have storms that potentially make that tree more dangerous. So,
all right, so no condition for.
I don't think we want to limit it. I think if it comes up,
that's
it should
point.
Be brought up in front of the commission.
Case by case. Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
I make a motion for negative determination, by the condition that we add two trees. The applicant provide two replacement trees, 10 to 15 feet tall, and then four shrubs along the embankment there. Chuck has a list of native trees and plants that we can get.
Can we open questions to the public?
Sure.
Yeah.
Any questions from the public? Yes, ma'am. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Yes. My name is Mary Ellen O'Neill. I live on Summer Avenue. I want to express my deep concern to the commission about the number of trees in general being cut down in our town. And I feel that there has a sort of fear of falling trees has become very popular. And, you know, large pines are meant to sway and bend, you know, and go with the flow and not necessarily snap. I think we have to be much more careful about allowing trees to be cut down, especially in these sensitive areas. They provide a lot of good. They store a lot of carbon. They provide a lot of wildlife habitat. And in my opinion, the trees in these areas are there before us. They're going to be there after us. We're just the stewards. We don't really own these trees. So I think we have to be careful. And I also am concerned that the commission actually doesn't have a tree policy. It's kind of sort of like whatever works, and kind of, you know, fumbling for some quick answer in response to this. I'm glad that they're not all coming down. But I think, given the responsibility that you have, that it's incumbent on you to develop a tree policy and how these situations are handled. And, you know, how many trees? I mean, it's not apples for apples. I don't care if it's a 4-inch caliper tree. I don't care if it costs $500. It doesn't replace a 40 or 50-year-old oak or maple or pine. They're not. They're apples and oranges. And it takes decades for that new tree to fill in for that, you know, the lost tree. We have to be realistic about what these are. We have to protect them. The tree companies are making a fortune here in Reading. Let's be honest about it. and they have, you know, they can cut themselves out of business. You know, that's what they're heading towards. But I would really strongly recommend that you have a policy. When things are, you know, you do give authorization for them to be cut down, that you're very specific and you know what you're going to do and what you're going to ask the applicant to do, you know. So thank you for listening.
Thank you. Okay.
Make a motion, man.
She did.
I think I did.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? All those opposed?
Ooh, I'm in favor. I sleep at the wheel. I've been moving for 3 days. I'm half asleep.
Thank you.
All right, so I have the determination, and I could, if you signed it, I can make those changes and then send it out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All of you who came in, did you sign in to the sign-in sheet in the back of the room? Thank you. Item 10, request for determination of applicability for 2016-02, 213 Charles Street, map 34, lot 186, Holly.
This is the one I was looking at.
All right. Is Mr. Holly available? Mr. Holly, would you like to talk to us about your project, please?
Yes, I'm looking to get permission to remove 7 tall trees in my yard, 6 being very tall pine trees, the 7th being, and I think you guys had determined that there was an oak, it was an oak tree, or a maple tree, I'm sorry.
It's a red maple.
Yeah, the maple is dead in certain terms of words. Reason being is, you know, I just bought the house a year and a half ago and have a 4-year-old daughter. I'm looking for the safety of my family, the safety of my house. If you look at the little map that I had written with some measurements on here, the three cluster of trees in the back left, the tree in the middle has been heavily damaged by termites, and a 25-foot piece actually fell off the top of that tree. I mean, I don't know if you had seen it when you were there, but and luckily it fell backwards and wedged itself in between 2 of those trees. Doing some research of my own, I'm just concerned that the termites are going to wander into these other trees, and I don't know I'm not an arborist by any means, but I don't know the condition of the inside of these trees, and obviously I don't want to see anybody get hurt. I understand that there are some give to pines, it is a soft wood. Soil type comes into play with these pine trees. I do have a 1-year-old black lab who likes to dig holes, and I can tell you that there is a lot of sand in my yard, which doesn't really hold roots too well. I mean, granted, yes, they are real, real big trees. I don't think there's a tree there that is under 100 feet tall. If you look at this map again, the one in the middle of the yard, which is approximately 57 feet from the house, that tree itself, I would have to say, is over 150 feet tall, and that is the one that I am mainly concerned with. If that tree would ever go and towards my house, it would demolish my house and possibly hurt us very bad.
We did a site inspection on Monday, and the trees that, we observed did have yellow tape around them to show us which ones he was talking about. The three white pine to the back left, that middle tree, did look in very poor condition. The tree in the middle closest to the house was a very huge, a very large white pine. That looked in decent health. The two trees on the right, I think, were white pine. They also looked in fairly good condition. The one furthest away, which was about 92 feet, that was a red maple, and I didn't think that was in bad condition. There may have been one branch that exhibited some peeling bark, but other than that, what did you observe, Mike?
So I would concur. The one in the middle of that tree cluster looked in pretty poor condition to me, and I think I would just support your notion. The one that's right in the middle, you know, that's shown 57 feet away from the house, and that is a towering pine, and that is very close. That one in particular is something that's very large and relative to the house, pretty close. We did also, separate from this, observe some yard waste that looked like it was being dumped into the resource area.
In back of the shed.
Mm-hmm. I will admit that was some of me. Okay, and when I originally met Charles at the site, he had informed me. And by no means am I making excuses. I'm a city guy. I didn't really know. We had just bought in the house. I thought it was okay.
Yeah.
But after Charles had said something to me, I have been getting rid of the clippings. That has ceased and will not happen.
You also mentioned when we were on the site visit that you might not remove all of the trees. Is there a possibility that we might convince you to keep some of those trees, in particular
yes.
to the right? Because those two,
yes.
the ones on the right, which are white pines, I think they look like they're about 56 and 87 feet away.
The 87 foot is the maple.
I think that's the 92 foot.
Yeah, the 92 foot one is the one about right behind the shed there.
Okay.
Yes, I have no problem. Those aren't priorities, okay? It was the three in the back on the left and the one in the middle. I mean, if I had to really prioritize, the one in the middle.
Can I ask, in terms of the site visit, I don't see a delineation of the resource area on this map, except for perhaps maybe on the town map, and I know how inaccurate those can be.
When we're out there, I'm going to step in before.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm going to give my opinion about where I thought it was, halfway through the shed.
There are two sheds on my plan. Can you sort of
square
one
back?
In the middle of the lot.
In the middle of the lot.
Concur somewhere around there, right around where the shed was.
Near the shed, kind of going parallel to the road.
Yeah.
A line parallel to the road.
I would
behind the
say
shed.
Those three trees with the one that has that's dead in the middle. That might have been a little bit up from there. Probably up on a little.
I think
bit
it somewhat slopes
yeah.
down this way.
So
okay,
the
grade goes to page right.
82 are definitely in resource area.
87 and 92 are in resource.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it goes, I don't know, I'm going to draw a rough line like behind these three and kind of over this way. I mean, we don't have anything drawn, but is that the wetland
right.
line?
And
is
that
the hydric soil line? And
something in that. I mean, for what you've done right there, I think that's... That
plus
works.
Or minus.
Yeah, plus
yeah
or minus.
For the sake of... Okay, I just... Because I didn't know if it was back here or if it was...
This is an area on our GIS website that gives the wetland line at the edge of the property, which is completely incorrect.
Completely
no,
incorrect.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I just wanted to get
is
a sense of that. Thank you.
Something like that.
All right.
These were out, and this was definitely in.
Yeah, I thought it kind of...
Yeah.
So you're saying this is the actual wetlands line, approximately?
This, well, this isn't.
These trees are in the 35?
What are you pointing at?
These would be close.
Anika's.
Oh, Anika's,
No, it's back.
Well, we're back.
So the 84, the 86, and the 91, are they in the wetland?
Yeah.
They are probably on the edge of the wetland.
They're on the edge, so they're in the 35.
Yeah, the 91 would be on the edge, and then it goes back from there. The 86, 9 is not even a question, it's dead. And usually when you see a cluster of trees, and this is where that last one and this one here, the tree company with their arborist sometimes tells you that when you take down one tree that you have to take them all down because they protect each other.
The root systems are intertwined and they hold each other up.
Yep, from all that. So I'm not seeing any of that. I don't know who's going to take these down.
Report for these? Did you consult with an arborist about these trees?
Personally, I know what I work with an arborist. Did he come out there? No, he has never seen it. But
your workings with an arborist and the information you've gleaned from an
correct,
arborist,
yes,
has brought you to okay. Also, another question I have about the site visits is: what's the condition of the lot? How much of this is lawn? And
it's
how much of this
to the front of the shed we were talking about?
Yeah, about halfway between the tree and the shed, I think.
Yeah, there's like
yeah.
Help me out.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Grass.
And that's another thing that that we talked among ourselves is that, you know, if you remove any trees, that we don't really want to see you extend that lawn any further.
I just have to cut more. I don't want to have to do
into
that.
The wet.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So if that's
if it's the one in the middle, that's.
Yeah, I hear you.
So if that's the edge of lawn, then what's the ground cover like, you know, between there and the rest of the property? What did you
see? Shed,
is it shrubby?
Behind the shed?
Yeah.
There is actually some skunk cabbage, I think it's called.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what it is? There is some that grows there.
Mm-hmm. Probably
yeah, it's shrub. You know, it's nothing tall. It's all surface.
All low.
Yeah.
With shrubs and
vines. I mean,
oh, yeah.
My dog gets caught up in it, but
yeah,
you know, nobody walks back there.
Any other big trees back there?
There's red maple.
A lot.
Okay. All
and
throughout.
Yeah,
this
and
back
there's
area.
A patch of pachysandra next to the shed.
So I don't know if this helps, but from my notes, I wrote this: the ground surface under the trees consists of lawn and typical forest leaf litter and scattered herbaceous plants and shrubs. I didn't identify
it. Yeah.
I mean, if you look at the one behind the shed to the right on the right corner, the only reason that's coming into play is because the way this ground is sloped going the back. I mean, if you want me to keep it, I will. But it's just the concern was that there's not really much there. It's kind of sloped away from the tree, which in turn is, you know, this side of the tree, you can see more of roots than the other side because that's where the slope is going.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I look at them all the time. I don't see those swaying as much as I do the taller one and those three on the sides. You know, those are my main concerns.
Okay. What else was I going to say? So the trees that are in, there's really one tree in pretty poor condition, and that's the middle of the triplet three on the left.
The 86 foot tree, yes.
Okay. And the approximate height of like the one that's 92 feet away, 87 feet away, 56 feet away.
They're all tall pine. There isn't a tree there under 100 feet. I can't give an exact measurement, but they're all tall, straight trees.
Yeah, okay. I guess just to voice my opinion, I wouldn't be opposed to the three between the two sheds, especially if an arborist can confirm that removing one would kill off the other two. I'd love to see that professional opinion. You know, the pine in the middle, in smack dab in the middle of the lawn, I appreciate what you're saying about an enormous, monstrous pine, because I happen to have one in my yard. And the closer you get to it, the more, like, just almost dinosaur huge it gets the closer I get to it. But it's healthy and it's thriving and it's, you know, and it's adding a lot of habitat value to the world. Is there any way, you know, does it get weakened in storms?
It sways pretty good.
Well, they do.
I mean, but
well, they do, and mine does, and mine does too.
I mean, it's probably 85% is right here. If this thing goes, my whole and we're in the house, I have a 1,500 square foot ranch, you know. And if this thing goes, we're done.
Right.
I mean, it's just when I look at it, I quiver. It's just.
It gives you nightmares.
Yeah.
I get it.
When I watch the news and I see these high wind storms, it's like, you know, I'm not going to leave my house.
And this has big branches broken off of it in previous storms.
Yes. Okay. I've had branches fall.
Yeah.
And to include that tree in the middle and the cluster of three.
Okay.
Like I said, it was a 25 to 30 foot piece, and thank God it went the other way.
Right. Right.
That particular tree that's the closest is considerably taller than any of the other ones.
Yeah, I get that.
And it's less protected than the other. You know, it is standing away from the rest. In my mind, it's less protected. You know,
there's nothing around it.
Any comments from the public?
Mary Ellen O'Neill, 125 Summer Avenue. So is the applicant willing to keep some of these trees? Are we talking 4 removal out of 7?
I did hear that.
I would be willing to work, yes.
Right. That I had asked, there were white pines on the right-hand side in the back of the house that appeared to be, there were two of them, and they appeared to be in decent condition, and he agreed to keep those.
Couple follow-up. In addition to recommending that the Conservation Commission have a tree policy, I lost my train of thought. Well, one is, this is the first time, I mean, I'm very interested, and I've always been a strong tree advocate, but I haven't been down to look at a conservation application before, and I don't know all the, you know, the terminology. But I was a little, and Chuck had explained to me, because he happened to be in when I was in this afternoon, and looking at the maps, we don't want to make things onerous for people, but I also think that these are public hearings and the material has to be understandable. And looking at the map, it wasn't informative. It wasn't clear as to where the wetland delineation is on the property. And I think that any application coming in, and if it's subject to public review, a citizen wants to come in and look at it, it should be clear. I should be able to understand that material without having to ask for help on that. Something so basic as where the wetland lines is. So whether or not the town, that needs to be clarified or more clear for people to access easier, but I think that should be, should be set up. And also, does the commission itself ever have the ability to hire an arborist for consultations, or do you ask town staff, town tree staff to come out and look at if you have any questions so that you actually can say, I think, instead of saying, I think the tree looks healthy, you can have someone, from the field say the tree is healthy?
The first applicant did have an arborist look at the trees, and so we take the recommendation of those arborists. In this case, he did not get a professional to look at it. Chuck, have we had Bill Keating look at anything? He's our
So Bob
tree
wouldn't
warden.
Be going on private property to look at trees. But it is true that usually when healthy trees are taken down, we have the opinion of an arborist backing up such things as it could fall, you know, it's going to weaken the structure, all that. And it just helps out because the professional's saying that this has to come down and he's putting his stamp and seal behind it.
So. Let me just interject, though, that the arborist of the company that's going to be doing the work is not an objective person. And I have spoken to representatives of a big tree company in town. They're going to take the job because, and even if they feel that all the trees shouldn't come down, they'll take the job because someone else will do the job.
Well, thank God you have this commission here to run, you know.
Right, but I'm saying that sometimes in certain cases, you might need to hire an outside,
We get your point, but like I explained at the window, when you, this is a substantially complete application. If this commission thinks there's something missing, this is their opportunity to ask for it. Not, I can't turn down an application that has most of it complete. It doesn't work that way.
I'm not saying that, I'm saying going forward, there's just a certain maps that just you expect to be used, so it's clear.
Right, so. So your question is to ask the commission, do they feel like they understand it? Those plans aren't for the public. They can ask as many questions as they want. Those plans are for the commission to understand, and this commission knows where the wetland line is. They've done it.
No, no, no.
What I would recommend, Chuck, is I think the right question is to ask, have we gone out to see where the, you know, where, to our best knowledge, the resource area is, where the wetland line is? And that's the purpose of A, getting an initial plan, and B, our site visits, is to actually go and see. And if the commission can sit here, my opinion is that if the commission can sit here and say, yes, we have a good idea of where the resource area is, I think we've satisfied the mapping in the application. And
I
we have an understanding of what's going on.
Chuck is our administrator who understands location of wetlands, and I used to be a wetlands biologist as well, so I can.
Oh, I'm not questioning, I appreciate that everything that everyone's doing, but you know, having looked at like going certain, you know, CPDC, the way they do certain things, or other people having public hearings, you just make that, you know, if it's out there for the public to view and comment on, and that's what this is about, then you have something that's, you know, understandable. I mean, I'm not saying that everyone's not doing their job. To me, it is part, as more trees may come under, and there may be more requests for that, and there's going to be more neighborhood or, you know, other interest in that, just that people will be looking at them.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So. Question?
You know, just thinking back, you know, I had an arborist in my yard, and I wanted to do, I mean, my goal as a homeowner for my own yard, knowing what I know of trees in town, and the spectacularly flourishing invasives in my yard, which happen to be some pretty fantastic trees, unfortunately, you know, that have had limbs that break off near power lines, and, you know, I don't want to cause damage to other people's phone or cable or, you know, whatever's going, you know, during these winter storms. You know, one of the options that one of the arborists discussed with me, besides adequate pruning, fertilization and treatment, there was also some mechanical bracing that is possible in some of the larger trees that can, you know, it's basically some sort of metal installation between major limbs to reinforce and just reinforce the significant structure that's already growing. You know, so clearly there are options, and if you get, you know, it just depends on what the goal of the owner is and what would they like to do with their trees. Now, since these trees are within 100 feet of the wetland line, and in fact, you know, those three between the shed are, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are most likely within the 35-foot no-build zone. You know, if any trees get taken down, they do need to be, I think replacing them is good for the habitat. Is, no, you can't replace in kind with, you know, a 50-foot tree with another 50-foot tree. It's just impossible. But I think getting it's important to me that the residents understand that, you know, this is a resource entrusted to you for, you know, good care and management. And, you know, I'd love to see every resident in town become a real steward of their lawn. And, you know, take whatever steps they can on a daily, yearly basis to make their yard just a little bit more native, just a little bit more habitat friendly. And you know, that can be done with, you know, and shrubs planted around your house too. You know, it doesn't have to just be done in the wetland or in the wetland buffer zone. I'm gonna stop my little speech now. I'd like to see something from an arborist. I'll entertain cutting down those three trees, those three pines, between the shed and the large 150, the very large in the center of your yard. If there's an arborist that, you know, can back that up. So that's kind of
back up. Well, I don't understand.
You know, can corroborate.
Can
your,
corroborate that
your
you know this is really necessary.
That it's really necessary for me to take down the big one in the middle. Is that what, I mean, you want him to look at all my trees? I mean, the one in the middle of the cluster of three is severely termite.
Well, the termite damage I understand, but I guess part of what I don't understand. Yet is that one that's really, really damaged is taking that down gonna destroy those two surrounding it? I'm not an arborist. I don't have that that knowledge. Unfortunately, I couldn't make the site visits. I was out of town, and I apologize for that. I would just like a professional opinion.
I would concur with that, you know, even just going back to our last applicant, you know, we kind of hit on, you know, whether or not there is a defined policy. We have a standard of this consistency. If something's taken down, we like it replaced, you know, and it sounds like typically we are looking for a letter from an arborist if a healthy tree is going to come down. So I think just in the matter of consistency, I'm completely open to these four, but if, you know, we're typically seeing letters from arborists, then I would expect no less for this application as well.
How do you feel, Ed?
I don't remember, since I've been here, requiring a letter from an arborist.
That's,
I mean, if we're going forward, that's fine. I don't think I have a problem with having this applicant have an arborist look at these. I think these four trees, the cluster, let's confirm that. If yeah, obviously the middle one, it seems like everyone concurs, has to come down, and if that's going to affect the other two, we'll take all three down.
In likelihood, will, yes.
And then, you know, if that one's too big and it looks like it's a hazard, a safety hazard, then I'd like to have someone say that. And I don't think that would be asking too much of the applicant. You could get an arborist and just confirm that those three in the back and that tall one in the middle of the yard are an issue, and come back and you know, probably that would be fine. Take those four down. Allow you to take those four down, I think. I think that's what I'm hearing from the board. Is that what everybody?
Yeah, you know, and again, I think I'm on the same boat as you, Al. I haven't been here long enough to
yeah,
necessarily
yeah.
know that that's what we see, but just from listening to Chuck and seeing a couple of sounds like that's the general trend. And if that's something that the commission thinks is important going forward, then
that may be okay. So we'll continue this. You will need to get a letter from an arborist talking about those four trees that we discussed. The middle pine at 57 feet, and then the three on the left.
And when would I have, how would I, do I have to come again to another meeting? I mean,
would
I,
continue
I'm just asking.
Yeah, we would continue this.
To Chuck and
yep.
take it from there, do I have to pay the paper again to have a notice put in? I mean, is it another process?
No, you don't have to.
No, this is a continuation.
When we continue a meeting, it means it's going to stay on the agenda until our next meeting. So if you get it by then, if you don't get it by then.
We'll just continue it until the
next
meeting.
Okay.
So it doesn't leave our agenda until we've settled it. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I will get that done, but if I may voice one quick opinion here.
Certainly.
I think it's that it's pretty unfair that now I have to go get an arborist. I mean, if we're gonna, you know, maybe it's something that you may want to consider putting on all tree applications. That when you do make a visit and you see live trees coming down, you know, put on the, hey, you should get an arborist opinion and include that with your application. You know, I mean, it's, I mean, now it's just, I'm just prolonging this now. I mean, it's been a long time. I mean, but I will do it, and I will get that for you as soon as I can, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda is 17, request for determination 216-01, 17 Springvale Road, map 10, lot 295, La Licata.
Do we need to continue this one?
I don't think we did.
Do we need to make it?
I guess you make.
I move we continue 213 Charles Street.
I'll second.
Those in favor?
The next date, the next meeting date is, Chuck, 27th?
27th of January.
Okay, so the next meeting that we'll discuss this at is the 27th.
If you have a report from an arborist.
Okay, do you need it stamped and signed? I mean, is it an official, do you need an official letter?
A letter from an arborist.
Doesn't
okay.
need to
okay.
be stamped.
Okay.
Not to be notarized or anything, just on their letterhead, their signature.
Okay.
We have, that's all.
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen
a
stamp.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
There's
I don't
no
think there's
no
such thing as
no arborist
stamp.
Stamp, yeah.
What was the date again?
Landscape
sorry.
Architecture.
27, full landscape architecture.
Yep. And Libby, you want to introduce yourself, please?
You ready?
I think we are.
All right. I'm Elizabeth Wallace from Hayes Engineering, representing Anita Valicata, who is here with us. We are here before you with a proposal for a 33.5 by 22 addition to be added to the back of the house. It is partially within the 100-foot buffer to a bordering vegetated wetland at the rear of the property. We have the erosion control about 15 to 20 feet away from the addition, just to keep everything away from the wetlands. We are completely out of the 25 and 35 foot buffer zone. This addition will have two entrances with landings supported by sonotubes, a couple sonotubes at each landing. There's also a very small open deck going to be constructed next to the addition. The wetland was flagged just this past December, and I believe that the Conservation Commission made a site visit on Monday.
We did make a site visit. Chuck, myself, and Becky were there. We did observe, we actually came in through the back from the Randall Road. We observed the wetland delineation. You know, this is an RDA, so if the commission decides that it's a negative determination, it doesn't really make a huge difference. We don't necessarily need to verify it, but I think it was myself and Becky's and Chuck's kind of just looking at it, it seemed like the wetland line may actually move a little bit closer to the home, but I wouldn't say more than 10 feet or so.
Which flags?
It would be flags 2 and 3.
And towards Springvale Road, about 10
towards
feet?
Towards Springvale Road,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Just those two, then?
Just those two. If you go out there, there's actually a little pine.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you can see that from the contour. It's kind of where it seemed to go. I know it looked like there was some auger points done, so it, you know, the we obviously didn't take any soil samples, but it's just something worth noting.
The grade, and so how did you determine the grade?
Just by looking at the general grade. So, again, this is not verifying a line, it's just worth noting that potentially in different locations of the markers. That being said, it still leaves it the structure, so it's just the proposed landing and steps closest structure, closest item being constructed to the wetland.
Yes, there are steps out the rear of the addition, and those will have support. That's just about a 5-foot landing. It's very small, just to allow you to get out of the door and go down the stairs. Same thing with the entrance right next to the existing house. There'll be a small landing at that too.
So really, there's still about 80 feet away from.
Even if you allow 15 feet fluctuation in that line, that's
it's still a long ways away from.
Yeah.
So it, you know, I don't. It's worth noting, but not
65.
Doesn't
yeah.
Sound like it.
Not going to affect this.
Correct.
Would like to mention that there was landscaped yard waste deposited back near wetland flag number 3, and I think you need to let your landscapers know that you can't be dumping some of that stuff near the resource area.
Can I just speak to that briefly?
Sure. Yep.
When we bought the home, my landscapers did notice that there was debris from the previous owner back there, and they've made an attempt to remove some of it,
okay.
But not all of it has been removed. I'll gladly remove it before anything takes place,
okay.
If that's what's necessary.
Yes, please. And there was another large pile, but we don't believe it. It wasn't on your property.
We don't believe it yet.
Where was it?
It was directly near wetland flag 5, wetland 6. It was a branch pile, an evergreen branch pile back there.
Number 11. Springdale.
Would have been, what appeared to be.
It was over on the other, to the right. It looked like, because there were stumps cut back there.
Okay.
Seemed like there was a lot of cutting that happened.
And there was fresh.
Fresh.
Wood on top of another pile of wood.
Yeah.
So.
So, is this going to be a full foundation?
Yes, it is.
1 8-foot foundation. Are you planning any drainage? Perimeter drain or roof drain?
There will be gutters on the house, on the addition. We are not proposing any dry well or anything.
There are three maple trees just highlighted on the plan. Are those, is there a particular reason, well, four trees, is there a particular reason they were called out?
Oh, no. I just
like
asked our surveyors 30, to catch any large trees out there.
And
there.
Oh, okay.
So I know how you guys like showing me the trees.
Yeah. You are taking one out for the addition.
Yes, that's
yep.
Actually... I wouldn't call it a tree, but it's a very large bush.
Hmm. Is that what you observed at the site
visit? I actually don't recall seeing
it. I don't really remember the shrub either, but it's outside the 100 foot.
Multi-trunked, big shrub there.
It seems like we were looking right towards the house, looking right at the house, yeah.
Okay. So the decking, so there's a proposed open deck between the two back wings of the house, and that's the full extent of that. Is there going to be anything put at the bottom of the steps? Is there going to be like pavers or?
I don't think so.
No, inside
the
buffer.
The one
attached to the addition?
At the proposed landing and steps.
Yeah,
you're going to need a concrete footing there, I would imagine.
Do you know what it's going to be?
Oh, sonotubes, yeah.
Okay, but when you step off that back step,
Yeah.
Are you gonna be stepping onto grass lawn, are you gonna be stepping onto a couple of pavers, are you gonna be stepping onto a concrete slab, is there a sense of what the applicant might be interested in putting there? I just see, you know, at the bottom of stairs tends to be a place where mud accumulates, erosion is possible, so, you know, I'm just curious.
Yeah, I'm sure there's gonna be something, but to my knowledge, I'm not sure what it is.
Okay, great.
Luckily, it's not gonna get any closer to the wetland considering how the stairs are built.
Right, they're not pointed towards the, one-story, two-story addition?
One,
okay. You know, this addition is really in the pretty far outer buffer zone, and since it is so far, even with that 10-foot of moving the wetland flag, I don't see moving those wetland flags, those 10 feet, to be, you know, a deciding factor on whether or not I would vote for a negative determination for this. So, but I do think it's worthwhile to make sure we codify somewhere in a negative determination or somewhere in this file that wetland line should be moved.
It may not be correct.
May not be correct, but you know, but it's approximate enough for the sake of our decision making.
Yep.
You could just note that it's not approved.
Yeah, not a verified line.
Right. But I don't have any further questions from the public.
Any questions from the public? Do I hear?
I make a motion for a negative determination.
Do I hear a second?
Well, add with the stipulation of noting that the line is not verified.
Well, I don't think we verify lines in the party A.
Bill, yes, you do. But it's been taken care of. We've checked it off. There's actually a check off on form 2 say that we're not verifying the line, and I did write it into our write up in the back also
that's not
verified.
All those in favor?
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Orders.
What do you mean orders for? Just trying to get in order. The last time I sent it across the table without it set up, I got some tongue lashing from people. There you go. Yeah, you guys couldn't find the right page. There you go.
That was me.
We have a continuation of the ANRAD for 270-00653, 25 Springvale Road and Randall Road. Map 10, lot 294, 296, map 15, lots 5 through 9, Hall. And we have a third party delineation starting in the next couple of weeks, but other than that, there is no.
Is there a representative from the applicant?
I'm sorry.
Should we ask? The applicant's not here, correct?
No. I don't see the applicant.
This is
just a
continue. Yeah.
Continuation.
Well, and
it shows up on our agenda, but there's really nothing additional to report.
Other than.
So will there be the next meeting?
Probably by the next meeting on the 27th, we'll have something to discuss. There was a little bit of a delay last week, and
because I've seen a bunch of people walking around the woods out there, so I didn't know what was going on.
That's
it was actually
that's
a survey
the next
crew
phase.
Out there.
It was because
I
saw them with the tripods and I saw the truck and everything, so I wasn't sure what was going on.
So it's also worth noting the last applicant is on Springvale right there. So the commission did do their site visit, we did end up walking.
All the way through.
Through.
But they were surveying out there, because they had like the one bus and the.
That was that, huh? Yeah, so the best thing you can do to keep informed about when the next meeting is and if it's gonna be held or not is to give me a call on Thursday, because the agenda would direct you to come into the meeting.
Yeah, because we got a letter.
Yeah, so we don't give a letter, we don't send out a letter other than the first letter, and then it's always continued.
Right.
And it's always gonna be on the agenda until it's closed. So it's misleading unless you know really what's going on.
Well, I mean, we saw a bunch of people out there, so we.
Yeah, so most likely.
And you'll see some more people out there this coming week.
That's okay.
Yeah, you can always ask Chuck ahead of time if we think the applicant's coming in or if we think it's gonna progress further. Again, the applicant doesn't necessarily tell us, you know, we have an idea when something further is gonna happen, particularly with this, because we're doing the third party review. The next step is going to be really the third party reviewer to come in, so we will know when that's going to occur in the next step.
Yeah, it's likely that there would be something to talk about, but I'm not sure about getting plans or anything like that.
Yeah, it's getting tight.
So can you just sort of recap what has, so just for those who maybe missed the first January meeting, can you just recap what happened?
There have been some issues out there with the original delineation of the wetland resource areas for the applicant.
That was by the guy who was talking.
Steve Erickson from Norse Environmental. Mm-hmm. And when, so we took, members of the commission went out and took a site inspection, and we kind of concurred there's been a lot of historical fill, and when you have something like that, you have all these, you know, ups and downs, and there's water here, and we actually took some soil probes ourselves, saw some hydric soils indicative of a high groundwater table that could be, you know, a potential wetland resource area. So it was very questionable. We had questions, so that we thought that it might be a good idea if we got a third party, an independent review that would be paid for by the applicant, but we would interview, you know, qualified consultants to do that 30-party review. That was our last special meeting in December, where we talked about, you know, the three finalists that had the time to go out and look at that, you know, in this window of opportunity in December, January. Hopefully it'll stay warm enough so that they can, you know, take some soil probes to see if there are any hydric soils. So that's where we are now. We hired one company, and they're going to start looking at the site. I think they were out already doing a preliminary. And they'll look at the old lines, and then they will do their evaluation of what is out there for resource areas.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Your name, please?
Lauren Casares, 25 Springville Road. Is that the markings each time someone goes out are continuously being removed later on, slowing down the whole day?
My name is Paul Dodge, 27 Wentworth Road. What she's trying to say is after the people come out that are being paid, they're doing the site review, they're doing their work, they're putting their markings, and again, someone
second
is
time.
Going out and changing the position of all the markings.
Have
so
you
now
seen
every
this?
Every single time you send somebody out, they have to redo it. So, well, the people that go out are noticing that they've been moved. I believe Chuck, when he went out there for the last meeting I attended, he said he noticed that markings have been moved.
So where's
so in other words, people are going out there and trying to throw off the thing. This is delaying a determination. I don't think that's fair either.
Well, one of the things is this is private property.
Right.
And people going out there and changing flags or removing them if they're not part of the commission or they're allowed by the owner.
owner of the property are trespassing, number one. Yes, there are a lot of flags out there. When we send our person out, those locations of the flags will be picked up by satellite, either GPS or survey. Now, if they were removed, we would know, the person who delineated would probably know that something had been taken, but they could redo that again because they would have that information in the GPS.
But it's still, it adds more time.
Yeah, and in between that, there's gonna be field notes taken, so they'll measure off each flag and.
I understand, I'm just saying, it just, it all adds up and it just.
I.
Makes it even more confusing.
True, they're used to it. There's some orange flags on the ground, and that has nothing to do with this process. That's, I don't know who put those up. We're talking about, there are flags out there which we thought were originally taken down, but the majority of them were still up, and so.
So, I mean, basically, the only thing you can do is simply put no trespassing signs up at the ends of the property and go over there.
Right, but again, that wouldn't be our responsibility, it would be the property owner's responsibility to do that.
You guys have no control over that situation.
Right, and to your point, if people are going in and moving or changing flags, the final surveyors that come in, and let's just play hypothetical, and if the surveyors come in and pick up the wrong flags, that's gonna become pretty evident once that final map is done. You know, so, you know, there are gonna be checks along the way, I think, and especially because this is, since this is such a complicated topography, you know, it's one of those things that we're also gonna do a sanity check on.
I just wanna make sure, because it's just a fact that, I mean, the gentleman that was here speaking to before your special meeting, he was more than willing to do anything he wanted, and they're not doing anything. They're just trying to let the process go, and that's all I suggest. It's just let the process work out, you know, and then people are trying to, you know, confuse the process, and it's just kind of a negative. You know, you guys are gonna make a determination regardless of what the neighbors actually think or the property owner actually thinks. You're gonna have your facts and you make your determination. Just wish everybody else would just be adults and let the process go on.
Thank you.
Well, I hope it happens.
Yeah.
So. We wish that,
I
too.
I hope it happens.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions about this project? Okay.
A motion to continue NRAD 270-06-53-25 Springvale till the 27th.
A second.
All those in favor? Okay, so we're now on to old new business, I guess, or with the determination of applicability on Oak Street.
Do you have paperwork on this?
No, is that it?
Yeah.
Thank you. You can stay.
You can stay for the rest of this.
Welcome you to stay. Is something we said?
Usually after we make a decision, they just take off. We appreciate you sticking around.
Is there a mailing list or something? Or what's the next steps, I guess? How is it as far as the determination?
Yeah, I send that off to you. You'll get a certified mail. You can come in and pick it up.
Okay.
Whichever one you want to do. And then there's a 10-day appeal period, and after that, you're free to do the work or schedule the work. So,
thank you all.
Thank you.
So let me catch everybody up on 28 Oak Street. This was, approved. The work
near Joshua Eaton.
Yeah,
the rehab
went out
house.
There and looked at this after the clear cutting happened, and the gentleman put in some. Planting, he submitted a plan, he wanted to do a bunch of planting, and we were all concerned about when he was doing this planting because it was going to get cold, at some point, but he wanted to risk that and get those plants in, you know, in November, late November, early December, and he did. But the commission asks him to not only get the 2-year guarantee, which I think he supplied, but a bond for $1,000. And I hadn't received the bond until Monday. So now that I have the bond, you may sign the determination and I will send it out.
Great.
So that's, I was just waiting for that final piece.
Good. Glad it came in.
So you have everything in place now to accept bonds, small bonds like that on a regular basis? You can accept it into the account and hold it and then disperse it when you're
ready? We use the accounting department to do that, but I have made up our own paperwork to start that. I'll send that around too. Can see what that looks like.
So I know Jamie had some questions about our legality to do that, didn't he?
Who, Jamie?
But
yeah.
We've accepted bonds.
Well, he didn't think
years.
We could do it without order conditions. Wasn't that it, Chuck? Is that his argument?
I didn't look into that. I don't know. What, I don't think Jamie's a lawyer, but.
But I mean, if there's
I
an
know.
Enforcement
no, I was just
order.
I mean, it's
yeah.
a question,
if
and if it's
an
a question,
order,
we should try and answer it.
I'm going to type that
but
in.
But
yeah, that was an
if
enforcement
there's an,
order.
If there's an enforcement
yeah.
order,
yeah.
that's
you have
not
to understand
happen.
The spirit of Jamie's question. It was, you're doing something, so I'm going to say the exact opposite.
Oh, stop.
And that's what it was about.
Stop. Listen, these small bonds I'm in favor of. I just want to make sure we're doing the right thing. I mean, you know, people showing up with just a letter or whatever, I mean, that doesn't...
No, I thought, you know, I go back to this. This was the one you pointed out. I thought you made a great point that time. Like, what's the letter going to do for us? That
you know, I'll also tell you that we're
a couple
kind of ducking away
although
because
it's the
we're
same
not...
Arborist that, we're the same person that wrote the letter today.
We're not freely allowed to use town council at all. You know, without permission, and some of these things.
Who do you seek permission from?
Well, if I thought it needed it, I would talk to Gene Delios.
Okay.
I would just run it up the ladder. I'd probably go to Julie Mercier first.
No, I think we're safe until an applicant tries to call us on it or something like that, and we have to explain
ourselves.
What's
the difference
maybe
between
then.
This permit and I
yeah.
mean, I don't know, you know,
well,
that's where the lawyer comes in.
Yeah,
you know, I don't know.
Well, there's probably a small difference, and we want to do it because it's our benefit. So I mean, just keep doing it. I'm fine
I
with
think
that.
As
I'm
long
just,
as they agree,
I'm just wondering if you took
to
the time to answer
no,
that
I,
question.
No, I just
obviously,
said,
obviously
no,
you
I
didn't.
I could care less. We wanted something for our protection, and if he disagreed, our you know to keep it at our level, we could say fine. This then this is a positive determination. We'll bring it to a notice of intent, and. You know, then you can pay your bond.
Yeah, I suppose.
Yeah, so there's very little risk to the commission losing.
Yeah.
No, that's the paperwork anyways. It's been.
If anyone gets yelled at, it'll be Chuck. We'll tell him. We'll all say he said we could do it.
Yeah, you're just checking to make sure
to
have my name on it, right?
Just shouldn't have to do any yelling, though. So the next item's on the agenda. Mr. Couillard
I'll go over there so you guys can beat me up.
No, you can't.
But we can't vote on it.
We can't vote on it.
Quorum.
Oh. Well, can we discuss it? We'll discuss it.
No.
Can't.
No.
Oh.
No.
All right, well, then we'll wait
until next
meeting.
And you're missing
yeah.
paperwork.
I have it right here. But, yeah, we'll discuss
so
it.
So why don't you do
meeting.
Chair mail and pass out the paperwork so everyone has it for the next meeting. But really, we need people.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need a Jamie.
Jamie.
Yeah.
Okay.
And you want any?
This is for.
Does it say
Mariano Drive?
Oh. What's that one?
Green Holdings.
That's it. Okay. Yeah, yeah. That's it.
So we're all set with Oak Street.
That's your
so now.
This
right
is what's
now
coming.
Awesome.
Here we are.
Okay, so we'll just continue
this is
those
nice.
Three.
we do.
I'm on TV duty.
So you guys are doing that. We have a bill to approve. So we have, you know, obviously you guys all know we're each week we're taking back more and more ownership in all the operations. operations of Matera Cabin, and, you know, this is something that the commission wants to, you know, really try to make something out of. It's being, you know, it's being used quite a lot by our recreational department, by the library, and the commission should try to get back in there also. So this week I was going to take Al there, but
I did a site visit myself twice.
But you didn't get inside.
You didn't go
though.
Inside.
I didn't go inside. No, I just looked at the construction of the parking lot.
Yeah, so.
I do want to get inside one day whenever you're available.
Yeah, so this week we went and looked at the inside, trying to figure out ways to expand that back area so you could actually have a workshop. Brought the building commissioner there, and we talked over, you know, whether it was possible or not, and he thinks it's completely possible to do that. And I think I'm working on that now. And if anyone's been there lately, you'll notice that the parking lot is actually a parking lot. It's getting bigger and bigger. It's not finished yet. They're still moving around material, but it's quite different. And I went there just before tonight's meeting, and I was quite upset when I saw a car still pointing into the direction of the woods. And I'm like,
right.
What does it take, man? But
bunch of signs.
Lines.
Right.
Park
yeah,
here, stupid.
So, but,
well, but
there's at least
we did
more
it,
of
though.
Them. More of them could
so,
fit in there. So.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, it's kind of exciting, and I talked to Mike Hannaford, who works with Bob Keating, Forestry Department, and he wants to get together, and he's going to offer some fruit trees for that area and some other trees. So we're gonna have a couple more trees in there and continually work on that landscape too. So by the time that outside area gets completely pulled together, it should look a lot different and more natural for people to park and enjoy
yes.
that upper terraced area.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, it should be good, should be good. And that brings me right back to the
bill
which is 17.42 for
we light that
the
place
light,
way too much.
The lights at Matera Cabin.
Lights.
So.
I move we approve a bill for 17.42 for lighting.
Lighting
at
bill.
Matera.
I will second.
All those in favor.
I am going to tap everyone here for some input on the annual report. That's going to happen. Either I'll send it out tomorrow or I'll send it out next week. And we need people to look at sections and take ownership of sections and write sections, okay? So that's, if everyone comes up with a paragraph or takes a section, it's going to be simple and easy. So that's probably what we should do.
It's simple and easy. Why don't you do it?
Because I'm the administrator. It's not you guys are the commission. Okay? This is
what's my paragraph going to say?
Well, you don't have to do it. Someone
I'm
going to
do it. I just
want
to know what do you want me to say?
Well, the way it's broken up.
I'll tell
like,
you what to say.
Yeah.
There's one thing that says Matera Cabin.
Okay.
One thing says open space. One thing says, you know, these are our projects that we did this year. And then you might pick one out of that and write something about it. Tell them after your concussion how when you awoke and you decided to become a conservation agent, how that process took place.
He's fiery tonight, isn't he? You might have a concussion in a minute. You keep that up.
I think everyone would enjoy reading that story.
It's a comedy. Someone adjourn this thing so we can get out of here.
No, we're not done.
We're not done yet.
We're not done.
Oh,
that was one of the things. Wait a minute.
I figured sarcasm was for the end of the meeting.
No. We're not done. We have, we are missing a chairperson. Brian, as you know, resigned.
Mm-hmm.
And so do we want to elect another chairperson, vice chair? Well, we don't need to elect a vice chair.
It depends on who becomes chair. I mean, there is a standing vice chair, but
right.
if the vice chair is elected to the chair, then we should have an election
That's
for
what
both.
I thought
so,
that we should have.
I have another fiery comment, but it's probably
I think,
not appropriate.
I think we should have the election.
What?
I don't think if you don't vote for a vice chair, it's perfectly fine, because
yeah.
in the past the vice chair hasn't really done much.
If anything, a stand-in in
a
the absence
in,
of
that's all stand-in.
That's the, but
it's
I think procedurally I think
for,
that would be good.
Except for our current vice chair, who's been
acting more like a chair,
crazy,
than
nuts.
A vice chair.
I don't know. Can't stop. Phone's ringing all the time with this one. But
sorry.
I have an idea.
But
just
both
so,
are good.
Just so that everybody gets their feet wet, maybe we should elect a chair, and if the chair needs to be filled in for, that should be done on a rotating basis by the board, so that everyone gets a feel for running a meeting.
I'm going to put my Jamie hat on.
Along the way.
I don't know that.
Are you? I think that's kind of what's been happening in my history with
because I know Mike's dying to be chair. He wants to sit there. It's for
so
yeah.
the
I'll let you run the meeting.
The policy. Let's keep it to what we. Let's make small changes.
Yeah.
So the policy in the past, and you know, Jamie is what from Jamie Mon would tell you that the way it works. You know, right or wrong, but the way it works is that we vote for a chair, and the vice chair ends up being the chair the following year or whenever that person steps down. So instead of everyone getting a taste, it's really you're really picking the next chair in a way, unless there's a big issue. So that's standard for this commission to pick both and just have that rotate.
Well, just, you know, I've only been on the board for a short time, but I've been before the board for a while, and since I've been before the board, I've seen a lot of turnover on the board, so
well,
you know, you pick a vice chair who's not there in a year and a half, or a year, I mean, I don't...
Well, the vice chair typically doesn't do too much.
Well, it depends on the vice chair, I think.
No, I'm not talking about...
I did call Brian a lot when he was vice chair.
Oh, you did?
I did. I called him, you know,
yeah.
I would ask him questions. And, I mean, he's
yeah,
got
and he was included in a number of meetings
so
when I was chair.
Yeah, but, you know, he was available for comments and questions, but, you know, and my comment about they're not around, like when Anika was chair, you know, everyone in town government still ask, is she still the chair? Because she went out and met everyone. She went and talked to everybody. She did not just once, but a bunch of times. So that's the activity I was talking about. So it does come with a little bit of responsibility, of course, and not just the 5.5 hours you spent at this meeting. So you caught that, didn't you?
We're whittling it down to 4.5.
I think with the dwindling board, I think we need some. I think we need. With the instability, I think we need to set in place the chair and the vice chair and just move forward. I mean, I think somebody leaves their position partway through. We just need to finish out the terms.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
So loose to because imagine if I needed a question and Becky, you know, I don't know, something happened, you know, you're not around.
She's on the mountain, you can't
who,
get reception.
And we haven't picked a vice chair. Who am I, talking to? Because the chair talks for the commission. The chair's not here, then the vice chair does. But if
right.
we don't have a vice chair, and I ask Michael, and he's not officially the vice chair, then
mm-hmm.
and then someone says, well, who told you could do that? Well, just one of the commission members.
Right, and
issue.
So that's a single-handed commission member kind of making a decision
so I'm
that the
just
chair
the
doesn't
commission
know about.
Member, that's all I am. Just a commission member.
That's
right
just
now.
It's pretty
man.
Low.
Just
right now.
But
well, you know, you can aspire to greater things.
No.
Think of it that way.
I'll have to go on another coma and come back out.
Yeah. That's the historic.
Well, that's fine. It was just a thought. I mean, I wasn't sure of the procedure
okay.
or the thought behind it, but
I'm
not opposed to a chair or a vice chair either. However it works is fine.
Okay.
And in terms of, you know, having it automatically assumed that the vice chair is going to become the chair, I don't think that that's necessarily a guarantee. I like to think that each election is sort of fresh, you know, but it does help to have, for a chair, to have someone kind of as a vice chair to consult, to fill in, to assist.
You have that go-to person. You don't have to.
You have a go-to person. And not just Chuck, but someone who's sitting in a slightly different position than Chuck. Not to diss your role at all, but just, you know, a slightly different responsibility set.
Can I ask a question? What's going to be the term on this chair? Are we going to keep? Is this going
it
to
goes
change?
To it went to July.
We
it goes
definitely
to July.
Gonna, every single time, every July, we have to extend
mm-hmm.
the current chair or vote
for
revote.
So this is
for,
for the period from now until July.
Right.
And we got a lot of pushback from Jamie when we wanted to go 2 years.
Right.
And
you wanted it one.
And I wanted to go 2+ years because it's kind of a thing you have to learn, and you get your feet underneath of you, and that seems to be within the first year. And the second year, you really get traction and you get going. So I thought 2 years would be great, 3 years would be great, but there was a chairman that this commission used to have that was very overpowering. And I think there was a comment made about not having someone in that position for a very long time. So, I mean, that's the feedback I got. So I think that story is true, that they like to see you vote in a chair. It's actually in the bylaw, the town bylaw, every July. Or,
you can vote to keep that chairperson going to the next year.
Right.
Right.
So that you got that continuity.
Right.
Yeah.
So given the interim period that this is going to be, and the fact that we this is filling a spot that we lost, so I would want to nominate Becky to move into the chair position, and Anika, put in your name as past chair to take that vice chair role, because, you know, we're trying to fill a spot. We've got newer commission members on the board. I think it applies an experience to the chair and vice chair, and still, you know, I think naturally Brian left and, you know, our chair left. I just see it makes sense when we voted last time that the vice chair is the person that should take over. So I just see the natural progression of Becky for you to move to chair and Anika as the past chair. It seems, you know, my recommendation would be to nominate you for the vice chair position.
I agree with I would second the idea of Becky moving to chair, because I think you're already getting your feet wet and and delving a little deeper.
Swimming.
Like from my own experience of being there. Once you get a little bit of traction, it builds and it grows and it's helpful for the Conservation Commission too. And in terms of vice chair, I was considering you for vice chair. I was going to nominate you because I think with your technical knowledge, it would be invaluable. I'm not opposed to being nominated as vice chair, and because I have continued to try, with minimal success, I've tried to continue to keep certain relationships going at the town level. I haven't been as aggressive as I was when I was chair, but there have been a couple of calls, a couple of emails, some attempts to continue to reach out to other parts of the town, and that hasn't been anything that the chair or vice chair currently has hindered. So I'm content with my responsibilities, but I can definitely step in as vice chair if
if that's the consensus.
I have a question. Should we be doing this without the full board?
We've got a quorum.
We've got a quorum. I think we don't want to delay. My opinion would be we want to just get an election in.
I don't think Jamie is going to have – I don't want to speak for him. Yeah, he could come back and say, what did you do?
I think the membership right now is kind of in dire straits. And
yeah,
since we have the four, I think we should strike while we can.
Okay.
That's my opinion.
I don't think they'd be in opposition anyway.
So. I mean, you certainly have to be at the meeting to vote. So it was on the agenda, and you know, I don't think you would stop us from voting. I mean, certainly.
I mean, especially because it goes till July.
There can
be an additional discussion. I mean, for goodness sakes, we are really pretty open to rediscussing things.
It's just a thought.
I don't think we're
Mike, do you have time to be vice? Do you want to?
I don't
know. Do you want to give it a try until July?
I don't know that I want to this early. You know, I think I've only been a member for 6 months.
You know what,
Anika,
that's fair.
I understand. I think it's something you can consider, and if you want to ask,
maybe
you know,
July.
Me about
yes.
it or Rebecca about it or somebody who, I mean, Jamie was also vice chair and chair, so you can ask him what his experience was. You know, so there's plenty of people. If you're curious about it, you can talk to.
Yeah, it's something I would definitely consider, particularly in the next period. I do feel that you know it's a position. Considering how few people we have, and to try to give a support, I think we should have somebody with as much experience as we can in the chair and vice chair.
Okay.
Is my thought.
Okay.
So just for myself, I think right now I don't think.
Okay.
All right. So it's Becky and Anika.
Did you want to make a motion or?
Make a motion that Becky become chair and Anika become vice chair for the term until July.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
All right.
That's it.
That might have been our easiest.
How many people signed up for?
That's because I'm easy.
Oh, right back into business. Sorry, guys. How many people signed up for MACC conference or intend to? I'd like you to do that online.
When is this?
I intend to. And I especially encourage members, Mike and Al, to attend.
Oh yeah, Al, you have to go.
One of these.
Yeah. Well, enjoy it.
I think.
Is there alcohol involved?
Only if you drive down.
Not
late.
At the beginning.
Only if you drive down.
Maybe at the end.
Yeah.
I think at the end.
I'll definitely
alcohol
meet it after
involved.
Class. I can't have it before class.
So it's.
Well, actually, you know what's really funny? There is a cocktail party at the end of it.
Yeah, there is.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, there is. Funny enough.
Yeah, Mike, what class would you consider? I'll take a class with you.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Isn't it? It's
should,
a day conference, right?
You take two in the morning, and two in the afternoon.
A conservation for dummies class.
It's a full.
There are
class.
Some
you
introductory
can,
conservation
can,
classes.
You can do those. MACC
unit classes.
Yeah.
I think this offers you know two different sessions in the morning, two different sessions in the afternoon.
Yeah.
I think I looked at the agenda.
Or one unit in the morning, one unit in the
afternoon. Just great giveaways.
Can I see that for a second? Is that the
which,
classes there?
No,
oh,
this
I
is just
it.
The agenda.
Yeah.
No. There's
Mike,
there,
I'll do what you do.
Okay.
Last
I'll
conference.
Let you know what I'm doing.
Well, there's
just
a,
so
actually
you
know. A really good one that I would recommend to you, and I don't know the full title, but it's the wetlands value ones, like what's the value of a wetland
that's
and
a
the classification. So how to recognize them and why they're important. And that's part of the series, and I didn't look at anything else, but I always thought that was a good one. What you don't need to take is like how to
write an order of conditions.
Or there's that one, and then how to end a conservation meeting before 12. Those things you probably you're, you know, you're a businessman, you know that. That's not something you need to do. It's a waste of time. But there are, that wetlands value ones is really good. Any ID class would be really good.
Are there any soils classes?
Well, soils take several classes to even get. So,
They don't offer soils class.
Sandy, clayey,
Silty.
Yeah,
I get notices,
but
MACC does offer during outside of the conference period, they do offer soils.
How long does
classes.
It take to get certified for a soils class?
You can look into it. I mean,
months,
a certification.
You have a certification,
take,
don't you?
No, I don't have a certification. But what do you want to certify?
I don't think you want to be a certified wetland scientist.
No. Just soils. Don't you get a certificate when you pass a soils class?
No,
it's not just one class. I think you need to take the variety of classes.
If you are going to do Title V septic, there is a certification for that. You don't want to be doing that one. But there is no certification for, like, Peter Fletcher's class.
You just take a class that brings
you
up to speed on identifying soils.
Yeah.
I wouldn't recommend Fletcher's because he gets into, you know, the touchy. You've got to.
You can feel the grain.
Squish it, and you got to get the.
You got to roll it into a ball.
It
rolls
to an eighth of an inch thread.
Yes, and.
Oh my! Come on, give Peter a break.
It's interesting, but it's not the he was low on hydro.
These are the workshops.
There's 27 of them.
That's what I know how to do. That's not a wetland.
Right.
Issue, that's soil.
It's a, you want to get a venomin or
soil
a tiner.
USGS, yeah, that's soil structures, USGS screens.
Yeah, tiner. You go there.
It's great. It's funny, too.
Before I sign up for any soils class, I'll ask you first who would be a good one to teach. Be a good one to take it with.
Oh, here we go.
What else have we got?
I mean, I know the USGS because of my geology work.
Right, but that's the...
Yeah, I know, and it's percentage and sum and like and
that
plus minus.
The like and sum is actually not USGS. It's a different system.
Here you go, Chuck. I got a class for you.
Which one?
Creative approaches to financing your commission.
Ooh.
Oh.
All right.
Why don't you take
that? I'll take
Al.
It.
Oh,
if you
yeah.
take,
I already
if
have
you
some
you
creative
take
ideas.
That.
A 5K run. I already came up with it. We're gonna have a.
Well, you know, you can give those ideas to a lot of other commissions around the state.
Well,
you can become the go-to on fundraising.
My board won't take me up on it. How's anybody else going?
No, you had a fantastic idea about doing a re-education program, a kind of a public education program.
Stormwater is really good, too, if you could just start in on that. It's not easy, but stormwater is good because this town is all about stormwater.
It is.
Commissions behaving badly. Lessons in legal liability.
Ooh.
I know a couple of those commissions.
Ooh. I took that.
Groveland is.
Groveland?
Oh my God! The state called them a
this
rogue
isn't
there, boy.
The habits of a highly effective conservation commission.
Is there a book on that?
Becky, you're the chair. You're taking that one. Isn't what's that? That is a ripoff from a book.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, yeah, 7. Did you ever read that book? God. Did you?
It's common sense.
So,
to what
this woman was, I don't know if we want to just discuss this. Do we have an open discussion?
Can I ask that we stick with
the
agenda? And
go
then
ahead.
We go to off topic, whatever people want to discuss.
Well, we've got
minor projects or?
No, we don't have any of those.
No minor
what about the artists?
Chuck is off agenda to start talking about this.
Oh, I know.
What about the artist?
At the right moment.
Back to it.
Assisted living facility?
We have the minutes if anyone wants to approve. We have two sets of minutes on here.
No, I know that, but what about this then?
The artist's environmental monitoring report.
I just sent that out to you because if you had been driving past, you noticed that they actually started building stuff.
Yeah,
so
I knew they built the wall.
Yeah, and Al and for the commission who knows this, but for everyone, you might know this too. As a commission member, just go to the trailer, get a hard hat, and you can walk the site and look for problems.
I actually had to go talk to one of Lynch's guys last week, so I drove in there. While I was in there, I was walking around, looking around. It looked fine. The sanitation looked fine.
Yeah.
I didn't see, nothing jumped out at me. They're all over that riprap at the gate. That everything looked, you know, I didn't give it a complete cleansing, but I looked around while I was in there, and it appeared to me to be decent.
And the report repeats that, and
yeah.
There were some substantial rain events during
yeah.
those,
yeah.
during that. So one thing never mind. Keep going with the agenda. I'm off
okay,
the topic.
Okay. The meeting minutes for Wednesday, December 9th. Did anybody take a look? I did.
December 9th.
December 29th?
December
9th.
We received December 9th. I didn't have any edits to...
I didn't either.
I do.
I say that. I know there was a typo that I saw, but it was very small.
No, the third page. Bill Fox at 35 Randall Road. That first paragraph, the last sentence, he explained that basically water comes up into soil, oxidizes, and leaves a chemical trace in the soil where the water has been, and that is an indication of hydric soils instead of that's what determines a wetlands, because
okay.
you need
it's
vegetation
indication
too.
Of
yeah.
hydric soils.
Yeah, I know he said that, but it's not right. It's like
mm.
And then the next sentence, paragraph, Mr. Fox mentioned ED. Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the next page, Melody Fox, 35 Randall Road, excuse me, the second line, Ms. Scanlon stated, registered with the Natural Heritage and Endangered Species Program. You've got National Heritage.
What is it again? I'm sorry.
Natural mm-hmm. Heritage and Endangered Species Program.
Okay.
And is Matera M-A-T-T or M-A-T-E-R?
I thought it was one T.
One T.
One
I
T, two
on
R's.
It's M-A-T-T-E-R-A,
oh.
Matera.
Oh, really?
Oh.
Is it the one T or two T's? One R or
I
two R's?
I think the sign only is one T.
It's one T and one R.
That's
but
what you
one
have.
One of them is doubled.
Really?
Then it's the T, isn't it?
I thought it was just one for each as well. I thought that's what the sign says.
Let me search.
M-A-T-T-E-R-A on the website.
Two T's, one R.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And that's it for... those minutes. Then we have December
29.
Randall Road is two L's.
That's what it.
It's a back and forth.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yes.
So there are a couple, there's about three of them that's one L. And then
there's this, go ahead.
26 Randall Road, there's a quote from me, Rebecca Long. Typically frozen ground stops delineations plus snow cover, shrouds, microtopography, and low growing vegetation instead of in ground condition. And then Mr. Flynn made a motion to approve Wetland Consulting Services as the third party instead of at. And then the last sentence, Mr. Moan seconded unanimous, that I think that's spelled incorrectly. You've got unanimous.
Oh yeah, unanimous please.
That's it. That's all I have. Do you have something?
Yeah, I just have two small things. Do we know if the resident that comments, is it Francis Coleman or Francis Goldman? Does anybody know?
I think it's Coleman.
Coleman?
I was matching some of the names too.
Yeah.
I think it's in, it's Goldman in the, it's just because they comment, has commented a lot, we should just try to get it right.
Isn't that like that movie, The Birdcage?
Yeah, that is right.
It's Coleman. No, it's Goldman. Remember that?
And then there's a question mark next to Jamie's name. I think that, do you remember what that was for?
Who's that?
The question mark next to Jamie's name. Did you not know if he said that or?
Yeah, that's what we're saying. I thought he might have said that, and he's not here, so we don't know it still, but.
That was it.
Then I guess just one small edit on the list of others present. The last name on the list is Lloyd Rolt, and one up, I think that's Melody Fox, isn't it?
Yes, she's the one that...
Yeah, on another, the previous, it is Melody Fox.
Oh, okay.
She's
yeah.
Miss Fox
okay.
is the comment and the later one, Lloyd Rolt.
Okay.
Any this
questions?
Is Coleman. Francis? Frank
no,
Coleman? Francis.
Who took the minutes on the 29th? Oh, okay.
I took them, but I combined mine with Anika's.
Okay.
All right.
So.
Yeah.
I don't know if you want to forward them to me, and I can.
We can.
I already handed them
over.
To Chuck.
Oh, do you want me to merge it or?
But these are the 29th.
Those are
these are them.
Oh, this. Okay.
Yeah,
I don't have a copy of it.
Oh, we'll
just
send
email
it to,
it to me tomorrow.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
You don't have a copy of this?
No, we didn't send.
So all these corrections we were making.
I'm writing it down, but I'm gonna have to get a copy of that.
So you
I'm just writing it
oh,
down.
Okay.
Second sentence, second paragraph. Okay.
Thanks. I was gonna say next time ask first. Would be happy to hand you an extra copy. Do you need us to repeat anything? Did you get it all or?
No, the Fox gonna confirm Coleman. Mr. Mon unanimously. So Randall Road.
Okay.
The low growing vegetation.
Make a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
I'll second.
Those in favor? Did you want to talk about minor projects checklist?
If someone wants to bring some added items up, it's fine. We can do that. We have some time. I was going to. I had another something else also. So the entrance to it was I think it's Bear Meadow, the entrance to the high school. Is that Bear Meadow Road or something like that? Have
Birch.
That wrong.
Birch Meadow.
Bob Keating has flagged a bunch of trees on if you're driving in on the left hand side. Can you guys drive past and give your opinion about that? The trees are old and in his opinion should be taken down for a safety reason because when people park there for events the limbs are falling on them.
Okay.
So I had them mark them and I'd like you guys to take
so
a look.
So when we drive
in from 28
take a left.
Yeah. They're going to be on your left hand side.
Past all the playing fields?
No. Right there. Right as you're driving in.
Right at the entrance?
Yeah. Right at the entrance.
At the entrance of 28.
Yeah.
At 28.
Yeah. It's between 28 and wherever the road is at the far end. So it's several hundred feet. Okay.
And he's marked them.
Look
right?
for flags.
Okay.
Right.
Is that wetland?
I can see
there's,
flags.
There's
wetland
something over
there.
There.
Yeah.
It's there's a wet area. It's probably a Redding wetland.
How many? How many trees?
Bunch.
Okay. All right.
Did we want to talk about...
So to bring up, while we're on the topic...
Trees?
I think it was, at the very least, a good point brought up. And, I haven't been part of the commission long enough. Are we typically asking for an arborist opinion?
No, we're not. We've
for
gotten...
For healthy trees?
We've gotten reports from arborists on occasion. But we haven't, I don't remember asking for an arborist report.
Mm.
Sometimes, the few occasions I've seen some people say, oh my gosh, look at that tree, and they've hired that Northeast tree company to come in, take a look at the trees, and they've rendered, this is in dire condition, you need to take it down. I've seen things like that, but I haven't seen us asking for them. Have you seen us ask it for it in the past?
It is, for what it's my memory's worth, and that's my disclaimer. I do remember asking for arborists to attest to the health of certain trees. Now, what was the situation under which we have asked for that? I can't remember 100%. You know, so I think I took. I appreciated Mary Ellen O'Neill's comment that we are looking inconsistent, case by case, loosey goosey about how we make these decisions about trees. And I think that that's probably accurate. And I think we need, I think we need a strategic planning meeting of some sort to really hash out ways that we can do our job better and easier.
More consistency.
If we start to develop a policy or a plan, something that isn't necessarily a regulation, but something that almost codifies our precedents, you know, our typical standard practice that helps us make our determinations. I think a lot of those, you know, here's how we typically look at most projects in Reading. I think a lot of that got dealt with when we were revising our minor project permit, and we came up with this outer, you know, the 50 to 100 foot, if that's what we're, you know, kind of like, what is the plan, you know, with, for me, things like, is it established lawn? Does the tree show damage? What is the impact? And, you know, is that something we should approve, or something we can just say, yes, we've always done this, we should continue to do this, or something we've been weak with and we need to strengthen, like some of our enforcement. Or, you know, I just think there's a lot of, I don't want to create a complete free-for-all type of meeting for us to discuss this, but I think there needs to be some place that we start to discuss this sort of stuff so that...
We've been talking about, you know, meeting at Matera to have a kind of a...
Strategic planning.
And if
it's not a bad idea.
And if we get out of that even a hit list of what's most important to people to make a priority, you know, where are we strong, where are we weak, and what can we do about it?
What exactly does the bylaw say about trees?
I don't think it specifies, really. I don't think it really, the bylaw doesn't go into trees. It goes into habitat or a buffer zone. And, you know, in my opinion, there's the law that says, our regulations say 25-foot buffer plus an additional 10-foot buffer. But when you read our regulations, the next sentence after that is, or any distance determined by the commission. And I think we've gone with the 10-foot with the additional 25 with the additional 10 as consistently applied practice in front of the commission. And there's strength in precedence, but I think we've been wildly inconsistent in a lot of other situations, like pools, decks, things that people want to do. Tree cutting, pools, and decks. If we can kind of throw out a number of scenarios where we've made a variety of decisions.
The one thing that I've seen that you guys haven't done that they used to do is when you increase the impervious surface, there's always been some kind of, you know, French drain or something like that.
Compensation for it.
And when I brought that up, I guess when I first came on the board, it was like, what? Remember?
Yeah, no, I was surprised because it beat.
Well,
but they had always done that.
Yeah.
And they had always done that, especially if it's in an aquifer protection district. So I've got 9 years experience seeing a variety of practices emphasized a variety of conditions emphasized or de-emphasized. And it's tough when people have different areas of expertise.
Yes.
You just can't impose consistent stormwater if our stormwater expert left. You just can't, you know. But if we can, for the sake of the applicants, and for the sake of the public message,
I think
we would get credibility.
A little bit of consistency.
We would get credibility, and we would have less headache ourselves, and they would have less headache, and Chuck would have less headache. So, done.
I think it's most of the stuff that you find is like, how do we protect it? It's in 3D. So the regulations. So if you just read through 3, ABCD, all that, you would. But usually it's.
I printed it out when I was first appointed. I just haven't read it yet.
Yeah, it's you have to. It doesn't. Sometimes it doesn't say it exactly. Like, you know, it says you can't cut down a tree, but you can't. You know, vegetation is left there to protect. To stop sediment from getting into the wetland or into the stream or something like that, and in order to protect the root system, and you can just kind of understand the spirit of what they're talking about. So that would be a section. So I highlighted section 3D when we did this one on 27 Blueberry Lane, because that's where the regulations allow it. And the only way that this guy can get his negative determination, checking off 3D in the box, is to have the commission say he's made a credible argument that he's afraid that the trees will fall down, and that's essentially what you've done, you know. And if you didn't think he'd made a credible argument, then you should have said, no, I need more evidence, or.
The guy that we sent to get an arborist letter.
No, this was a guy before that had the
nine guy before
trees, and he was
had
only cutting
the
four
yeah.
in front.
Yeah, but I what
but it
I
works
kn-
for
I
the other
known.
One too. Same 3D.
It's the same
what
thing.
What I hadn't known is that he had come in for more previously. I didn't know that.
Previous owner.
No, previous owner
oh, the
did.
Previous
completely denied. All of it.
How long ago?
I can't remember his back. Like could have
did,
could've
did
been
this
all
guy
back
know
day.
About
yeah.
that?
Yeah, I told him when he first
oh,
came
okay.
in.
Okay, okay.
Yeah. The trees, I mean, you have to be realistic. I mean, I want to save the trees too, but I also don't want them to fall on someone's house.
I know.
And
but any tree that is tall enough to strike a house has the potential to strike a house. I just think it's getting a little crazy.
So I'll give our continued, and I mentioned this when we talked, I'll give our continued, there was a tree in this backyard that was, I mean, it was huge, and I would have that same concern, and to me, I think there's on any, property, I think there's room for, to think about it, I don't know, I think we owe consistency, and then we still have a policy of replacement policy.
Right.
And I know
we have been inconsistent on that one too.
It
and that one kind of is odd to me because it's that you can do real consistently. You know, I like the idea of the shrubs or trees, kind of one to one. I like it.
Yeah.
Well, and other things that I've seen implemented, if trees are cut within a buffer zone or in a wetland, maybe a certain stand of like 8 or 10 feet is kept there, a stand that isn't damaging to their land or their property, but also provides, after the tree stump dies, habitat for woodpeckers, and other creatures to come in and use it.
But is that more viable than just a replacement?
I don't know.
I think a lot of this can be discussed.
I remember when Fran was here that anything in a wetland was left as a
left
stump.
In. Left in.
You know, as a so that you could have cavity seeking critters and woodpeckers
yeah.
going after
mm-hmm.
it.
In the wetland.
That's in the 35, right?
In the wetland or in the 35?
I think it was in the wetland.
So when you work in a wetland, usually you don't allow that to happen unless the ground's frozen and you're just going to drop the tree and leave it.
Right.
So
I think anything outside that 35-foot no disturb should be able to be cut down and replaced. It's a renewable resource, and I think we get a lot of benefit out of replanting trees of our choosing, trees that are on our list.
So is that different than what I just said? That is, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we should have a consistent policy. If it's outside the 35 feet, you can cut it down, and we can be specific on, if you take down a tree from 35 to 100, here's what you have to do. You either have to replace it with a diameter tree that we want, or the shrubs that we want, and we could finalize that any way we want. But I mean, I don't know why I would be bothering with something. If it's inside that 35 no disturb, well, then I think, you know, we should ask for an arborist, we should make sure it has to come down, we should have some additional conditions, we can talk about things like that. But if you're here and you've submitted a plan to us and you've convinced us that the tree you want to cut down is outside the 35-foot no disturb, okay, yeah, here, plant a tree here, plant a shrub there, and you're good to go. You agree to that, you're good.
If you cut down a really, really mature tree and you plant, like for example, that 150-foot tree, and you plant a substitute, the groundwater table in that lawn during the summer is going to be higher.
Yeah, it's going to change.
It's going to be significantly higher. The amount of water that's drawn out by that tree during the summertime in that root zone is going to be a lot. You know, so in a way, cutting down that tree and saying, that's fine, you want to cut down your 150-foot tree and replant a substitute, that could affect basement water tables.
I think that's substantial. That would be really
could.
Substantial. Well, that's at their own risk. It's their property. If they want to cut down the tree and flood
their basement,
that's not
on us. But they may not know that.
I mean,
that might be something that from a conservation standpoint.
I have no issue with you telling that to an applicant, and if he changes his mind, then fine. If he says, oh, geez, Anika, you're right. Maybe I don't want to cut that tree down.
And his neighbor who's here, who maybe he's in a quabble with, is going to say, well, I know what he's going to do. He's going to cut it down because he wants to make my life miserable. You know what I mean? And I know these things are going to
come
up.
Well, that's not. Yeah, that's not.
And
our,
these things are going to come
that's
up.
That's not our issue.
It's not our issue, but you know, it's one of these things. I think we need to really solidify our technical justification. I think we really need to kind of be grounded in the science and the goals of conservation. Not necessarily. I think it's okay, or I think it's not okay.
I don't think the state has any rules on trees either.
They leave it up to us.
They do. So, what's that section where you can only cut down so much of the canopy?
That's for pruning.
Yeah.
You can prune up to 25%
vista
of your
pruning.
Canopy.
You're right. It's called vista pruning.
Yeah.
So within a certain distance of a resource area, you can only prune so much. So you could look up vista pruning and find that out. I mean, these regulations trump that, so I guess that's why I don't know it. But I know there's a vista pruning section.
But we don't have a regulation. You're telling me that it's unclear. It says
for what?
Whatever we want trees. For trees.
Well,
you're telling me that our bylaw is unclear.
You're not going to be cutting trees down. Well, you know, the question's up to you, but when people come in to me, I say that if you're 50 feet away, you have, you know, you should do an RDA and talk to the commission. It's more likely than not. So if you're at least 50 feet away, when you're at 35 feet or 25 feet, you know, that's really where we don't have a policy and where we need a policy, when it's 25 and 35 feet away.
Well, we have a 25-foot no disturb.
Well, this guy was just this guy right here on 213.
With the big pine tree, he's within the 25 feet with the rotted tree in the middle.
He's within 4 feet.
Yeah, I mean, he's right.
He has a couple in the resource area.
Well, we did.
Those were the ones we asked.
Yeah, I wasn't on that site work, so I don't know. But we asked him to give us a letter from an arborist saying that the trees are damaged. Obviously, you guys agreed. I was on the sidewalk. Well, you guys agreed that that middle tree was damaged.
No.
Yes.
The middle tree was damaged.
So if the arborist confirms what Chuck thinks, that if you cut down that middle one, you're going to possibly kill the other two.
Well, you're going to compromise the root system, loosen it, and that's when you see a lot of trees toppling over that look healthy because they were commingled with the other root system.
And the other system that happens
is when you cut, when there's three trees together, you know that the branches don't grow into each other, they grow outward. So when you cut that one down, half the tree has no branches on it, it's lopsided, it's going to fall over. So that's the other thing they got to look at to make sure it doesn't happen. But they could cut the middle one down and then pin those two together, or maybe they could, I don't know. It's, I mean, you could.
And of course, you could do anything. I mean, if you have enough money, you could put a bubble over the trees. But and the other tree that guy had in the middle of his yard, the 150, that was outside the 35 in all likelihood, right?
I think it was on the edge of the 35. Right, 56.
So if we're not sure about that, then we have to require a wetlands line.
Brought up a good point. There was no location of the wetland on that.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, all that stuff. You can look and say, Chuck, how come this plan came in? Which is fine. I mean, probably only have to say it to me once. How come this plan came in without a wetland on it and without distances?
Well,
you know, I think I did ask him for distances, but I think he didn't get what I said.
Yeah,
I
he
meant
put the distances
from his house.
But at least that allowed us to have some discussion on which tree are we talking about.
But,
that helped.
You know, being an advocate for the applicant, you know, we're talking about some significant money. Mike has an idea how much it costs to have your wetlands flag located by an engineer, brought in, hire an arborist, you know, you're talking $2,500.
The point of conservation is not to be the advocate for the applicant.
Well,
I can be whatever
commission member I want to be.
You can, but our responsibility is to protect the interests of the act.
I don't think trees outside the 35 are really significant in protecting the act.
I think we
have replication areas, right, Anika? We allow replication areas everywhere in the state.
We do.
So let's replicate the tree. If we get a new tree, that tree is going to be there for 200 or 250 years, a brand new tree, where that one we cut down has already been in 7 or 8 years. It's only going
to
live 100 years.
You have to also consider the change you are fundamentally making to the area.
Go ahead, Chuck.
I think it's minor.
You say it's minor because you're saying one for one.
I think what
but
it, can I
it takes
just,
time to ramp up that
here.
Habitat area.
I worked with Anika. I'm going to tell you exactly what she's looking for. She wants you to know the value of a tree in the 35-foot area that's 30, has a DBH of 36. And then she wants you to compare that to what they're planting and understand the difference. And you're not doing that because you just see it as
minor.
Yeah. And it's not based on environmental thoughts, let's say. And that's what we're getting to. I understand what you're saying. And I'm not going to have to agree, but I'll say a lot of times I try to look through the lens of the applicant and leave the other stuff up to you, the commission. You know, this guy wants to take a tree down. He's scared about his daughter. I remember when my kids were young, you know, that tree is pretty big next to his house. You know, his house is not very big. I mean, it's, you know, something's got to happen. Things do happen. These trees do break and limbs do fall. So that's why I usually ask, and I don't know why I didn't come up with this one. If we're cutting down trees and they're healthy, usually I'm getting a letter from a tree company. And maybe it's because he doesn't have a tree company yet, and they weren't involved in this process. It was just him identifying trees and saying these ones need to be taken down.
Well, then we get into the whole thing. This woman who was in the front row hit the nail right on the head. That it's the same thing what I said, that, you know, a letter from a guy with a lawnmower. we're taking a letter from a tree, we're taking a letter from a guy who's gonna get $1,500 to cut the tree down. So now what, are we gonna have peer review for every arborist that comes in and writes a letter for the tree?
That's
I mean, we can't do that.
No, that was very cynical when she said that, and it's in a cynical attitude, because we have the experience of the commission, and this commission goes out to every site and looks at the tree. And if they say, you know what, 2 trees ago, you said the same thing, and I was curious about it, you know, tree company X, and this one here, I'm definitely going to say it. You need to prove to me that this has a crack. Now, a lot of these trees companies say, look, this is a lightning strike, there's stress cracks, there's all that. And they'll actually identify them too.
They
with me
core
out
it.
There, they'll you know, you look at the tree, you look at it closely, and you say, oh, really, there is a stress crack. I looked at a place tonight, or today, and it was all limbs broke off, and there was a hollow in the tree, and it was close to the house, and it was leaning towards the house. I called the company right away. I said, look, I don't want to have this. This didn't even get to you guys. There's no way we're not allowing this stuff to be taken down, because it was too dangerous. It was too dangerous for me to hold it off for a permit. Mm-hmm. You know, it didn't make any sense.
So that brings up another thing I'd like to bring up. What happens, God forbid, if that guy, this guy we already said about the 4 trees, he had his letter. But what happens if the guy brings a letter and it's from Northeast again for the 4th time, and we say, hey, you know these Northeast letters, we've had a bunch of these, and you say the same thing every time, we're not going to allow this, right? And 2 months later, the tree comes down, and God forbid somebody gets hurt or killed.
I don't question it once the letter comes in. And my own personal policy is if, because Jim over at Northeast, he's an arborist, and if he wants to write down that that tree is diseased, and it's not, that's his problem. That's not mine. I'm not gonna spar with him after a letter's written. It's that's not how it's done.
But we can also be there when the tree is being cut down to observe what the tree looks like after it's been cut, because it's clear once it's been cut.
We can't get a full board for a site visit. How are we going to go to every tree cutting down?
If somebody is,
I'm quitting my job now.
That's true. I know it'd be nice to have a policy, or not even a policy. It'd be nice to write some sort of replacement policy into the regulations.
Yes.
And we could borrow that from another town and kind of adopt.
I think a replacement. So it's clear. So you're outside the 35. You've got.
Now you're pushing for that, but I don't know if
it's bingo, and you can replace.
Yeah.
If it's inside the 35, it's case by case, and you know when everybody.
Isn't it very difficult to change our
regulations? Yeah, it would be easier for us to literally write policy. And then put a memo-ish understanding document together.
So it's hard to.
What I hear though is we as we've already discussed, we want to have a strategic planning meeting.
So hold on a second. It's hard for us to change. I believe it's hard for us to change our regulations.
The
bylaw we can change.
I think it's the other way around.
Okay.
I think it's hard for us to change the bylaw.
But the regulations,
however, the regulations we can. However, if we are to change the regulations, there needs to be...
The regulations, right. The bylaw we can change.
If there is a change to the regulations, there needs to be...
It needs to be addressed in the
I think there needs to be some degree of public involvement.
See, we knew.
And public notice, and then followed up our regulations, proofed... and got the final okay from town council.
Well, you know, guys,
as final regulations, because that's what we're using as our working legal document.
And if we go, you know, setting policies on our own outside of those regulations guidelines, you know, guys like Erickson, a lot of guys up here before us, they know those regulations as well as Chuck and as well as you do. They know every word in there. And the first thing they're going to say is, that's not in your regulation. That's not in your bylaw.
But the commission can have policies on decision. And if they want to call it, it's the same thing as the bond. If they want to call it off,
we are
the discretion of the commission. There's a lot of that wording.
The whole purpose of the Conservation Commission is we are granted by the state to have the authority to make judgments based on the science, based on reasons we can give.
Isn't it based on the Act, the Wetlands Act?
It is based on the Act, but it's also based on the evidence we get from the applicant and we can write into that order of conditions to support, the evidence supports
so,
our judgment
so why,
on
so,
that
so why
situation.
I've heard tonight several times, why are we, the word precedent, why are we even saying that word then? Then every
because,
application that
because,
comes before us is a completely different application than the one before.
Because
it should all be met on their merits, and we should decide on the merits and not have anything.
Because there are these things in the law called performance standards, and I encourage you to read the regs and the laws. So there are these things called performance
laugh,
standards,
Chuck.
And the
I'm
just saying.
This is a
I'm
this
not,
is a conversation from Matera Cabin.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
I'm
yeah.
not going now,
yeah.
but.
But
what's so this lady, did she come before you before?
She came in this afternoon, and we had a conversation at RMLD once about tree cutting. And she is, you know, it would be great to have her. And I know that I think that Al and what was her name? I forgot her name.
Mary Ellen O'Neill.
Yeah, I think Al and Mary Ellen, both of them, could come up with a great tree policy because they're just opposed, completely opposed to.
So between the two of them, we'll get the middle.
Diametrically opposed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'd have some good action out of that. But she wants to...
That's not the idea, Chuck.
She was talking about a real tree policy that's not, that the commission isn't in charge of for every tree throughout Reading.
Yeah, we don't have that jurisdiction. Yeah. But she didn't understand that, right?
No, she did understand.
That would be
something. I think she knows exactly what she's asking for.
Anika, do you know... somebody told me, I think... I'm sorry, Chuck. Somebody told me, I think Christensen was talking about trees, and he was talking about the percentage of trees in Massachusetts is significantly increased in the last 100 years because all the farms are gone.
Yes.
All the farmland
yeah.
that used to be in Massachusetts is now trees.
That makes
yeah.
sense.
And I was saying how many more there are. So I'm just wondering.
What's the big deal about
well,
keeping
not
trees?
What's the big deal. I'm not being a jerk.
Well,
I'm, just,
have
I'm, just,
saying.
I'm just wondering what percentage are we at, and where do we think we need to be as a state? And maybe that can help determine our tree policy
well,
as well.
You can't look at it that way because...
Just roll
yes.
the clock back another 100 years, and there were more trees then.
If we go back 200 years?
Yeah.
I was still in a
yeah,
coma
but
200
you're,
years
you're
ago.
You're talking about the agriculture. Yeah, there were no trees in Massachusetts, basically, but... But you're looking at kind of a suburban, urban area here, and we have, we do have a lot of trees.
Is there a point where we would have too many trees? We would be saturated with trees?
You know, what it comes down to...
Well, you change your habitat, is what you do.
It's not causing accidents, just like the deer.
What it comes down to is what degree of tree population do you kind of want to maintain in Reading? I mean, if you buy a history book of Reading, you'll see that at a certain date and time, you could stand at that mobile station or where Harrow's used to be, and it's all forest looking north on 28. Total forest. You know, so...
And you're not going to go back to that.
And we're not going back to
suburbs.
That because it's ridiculous.
No,
it's ridiculous.
I'm not saying we're going back.
But
I'm just
compared to what
to...
we're at now... With the understanding that this is the biggest, there's two important things that trees do under the Wetlands Protection Act. They help manage the
water.
And they help provide habitat. Okay, so, I think a real estate agent said something like, you know, the perfect time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. You know, in the spot you wanted it to be in, ideally for what you wanted to do with your yard. You know, so once you get these things growing a couple of years out, no one's going to up and move them, you know, until something happens and all of a sudden they decide they got to cut their tree down. But the instant that big, huge tree is cut down, it does make a difference. And it might, and it's not going to take, it's going to take 20 to 30 years if somebody wants to bring it back to what it was before the tree was there. And if that's what we want to do, then that's okay. And if we want to define where we think that's okay and where, you know, but just I think we should have this discussion further.
Yeah.
Because I think we could probably hash out something reasonable that
right.
everybody could agree to.
Instead of Mary Ellen, do you and Al want to put together a tree policy?
At Matera.
I think we should all put together a tree
this
policy.
This would be the only thing we talk about. You need to come to Matera with a draft.
With a draft policy.
Yeah. So
I could do that.
Have a coffee date for you two to start this, and you can. can give us an update at the next meeting on the 27th. Is that enough time?
What do you say, Al? I could work on that.
Well, unfortunately for you people, unfortunately for me, I am going back to Florida.
So are you not going to be around for the for later this
month? Do they have computers in Florida?
Not by
you don't want
not by the pool. Well, I'll be.
Wait a minute. You were just
the level
down
of commitment's astonishing.
I have a condo down there. I go as often as I can, which isn't often enough. But I'm scheduled in for the 22nd, and then I'm back on February 2nd, and I think that's it for this winter.
So you're going to miss the 27th meeting?
I am. That's what I'm saying.
Was there someone else missing it?
No, I'm missing the one after that.
Okay.
I'm away the one after that.
Oh, in February. This one in
February.
When are you leaving? The 22nd?
It's
a good thing we're chair and vice chair.
Yeah.
Maybe
I'll,
not.
Yeah, I'll try and get
are you
gonna
be
before
around?
Then.
Or are you
okay. Maybe you guys can
yeah.
schedule it before the 22nd.
I'm going to be around.
Yeah, I'm going to be around.
Barring
family
February emergency.
Vacation is not the week we have a meeting, right?
I'm not going to be around February vacation.
Yeah, we're not. We don't have a meeting then.
I'm skiing.
The 10th.
Yeah,
oh, cool.
10th. No, you snowboard.
We're going to well, whatever I'm doing.
Sounds like you're rolling down the hill because you haven't done it very often. You better bring a helmet. Anika, you live near me up on near Hopkins?
Yeah, I'm on Woburn,
so
on the west side.
Maybe you come
I can
come
meet you for coffee.
Well, just come to the house and we'll sorry, we'll keep the office there and we'll sit down and we'll
pick a date.
See if we can write something up.
We need a referee.
Weekday or weekend?
I don't think we need a referee. I think we can be civil.
We get along just fine.
I think it's fine.
It's all you knuckleheads that make it worse than it is. So, I don't know. I'm going to... I'm moving now. We're just getting settled in. So, I'd like to look like the 19th or 20th.
Of this month?
Next week, yeah.
Let me just take a quick peek at my calendar.
19th or 20th, we could do it like early evening or after dinner with the kids or something, 6 or 7.
You have kids?
I don't have kids, no.
No,
I was
talking
she
about
has
my,
kids.
My three muckarakas. Why don't we set tentatively the 19th?
Okay.
Oh, the 18th is MLK. Kids are off that day.
It's Monday.
Tomorrow, yeah, this upcoming
Monday.
Yeah,
Monday's the holiday.
Is that
correct? Correct.
Maybe Monday.
Monday the holiday?
Yeah.
I'm around.
Okay.
I was going to go to the Martin Luther King breakfast at the high school. But
were you?
I guess I'll have to.
Were you? That's pretty good. They've done that. All right. I just need an address.
61 Hopkins.
Okay. All right. And a time?
Whatever's good for you. You want
we'll
afternoon?
Say
or night? You want to do it at night?
Yeah.
6?
Can't do that.
7?
7:30?
I'm throwing you out at 11.
No. I'm walking out at 9:30. Because I'm going to stop making sense around 9.
All right.
Okay.
Any other items on the agenda we need to bring up? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
Move we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
Yeah, I
remind
there it is.
Me Monday morning at 9 o'clock.